curiosity. So last week I did a presentation on advanced custom post types UI. That was a plugin to help you create custom post types. What I'm going to be showing you today is a plugin called Advanced Custom Field, which kind of goes along with the custom post types. What it does is it actually allows you to create custom fields for either your custom post types or one of the post types that are built into WordPress, which are pages or posts. There's actually also attachments, page revisions, and add-ons, but we're not going to talk about those. We're going to talk about pages and posts. So let's go ahead and get started on the dashboard. Okay, so here I have the advanced custom field. I'm just going to search for it, so I just wanted to show you a little bit.
This is a really good plugin. They actually just updated it this morning, so the latest version is 3.1.5, and they just did that this weekend. So it's constantly being updated, which is good. All right, so it's installed, so let's go ahead and activate it. When you activate it, it will add this on the left, custom fields. If you go to settings, you think there would be a lot there, but there's actually just a way to activate the plugins that you can buy. So we're not going to talk about the settings. I wonder why that keeps going smaller. But we're going to just jump right into custom fields. What it allows you to do is create a field group. So I'm going to show you how to do that. Add a field group. And maybe if I give you kind of the word. This is actually when you're in the edit page under posts. This is what we're going to do. We're actually going to create some extra meta boxes to collect information. And then this is what it looks like now. So we're going to add an ingredients on the right.
Okay,
and we can add some extra fields on the bottom. And those will be recorded in the database, and you can display them later with your theme. So let's go ahead and go to the custom fields plugin. And we're going to create a new field group called ingredients. And then once you give it a title, there's a few options that you want to set. And the most important one is location. This is actually very powerful, and I've only really scratched the surface of it. It's probably about 2% of what I know of this plugin. It's so powerful. But what I'm going to go over, there's a lot of different rules that you can set up. You can use all of these different criteria here. Today we're going to use post type is equal to post. If you had created a custom post type, you could set that here. Right now we don't have any custom post types created, so it's just showing us post or page. And then down here the options. It allows you to set the order, and then normal merge side. And actually, you want this to appear on the side of the edit, so we're going to check off side. And then the style, there's a meta box style, and then there's a no meta box style. The standard meta box is gray, and you can drag and drop those. Just like any other meta box, you can hide those. The no meta box acts more like a form where you can just input information, but you can't really drag that box and put it anywhere you want. It's pretty much set where it is. You can also have the ability here to hide different sections of your page, the content editor. The thing is, if you have more than one group, it's going to go, there's a little note here right about it. If you have multiple groups that appear on the edit page, the first group's options will be used. So if you're having a problem and you want to hide the content editor showing, you might have one of that displaying all of these here. All right, so we're going to go ahead and add a field here. And we're going to label ingredients. And The field name will populate from the label. It will use underscores for spaces. And the important part here is the field type. And there's a bunch of different ways. Text would just be a plain text input box. There's a text area, that's the one that we're going to use now, but there's some other ways, and I'll show you those as well. But right now, we'll just do text area. And we're not going to set a default value, and the formatting, there's going to be auto breaks of it. Field instructions, you have the blank ingredients. We're not going to make them required of them. We're just going to click on Save Field. This message will come up whenever you're creating a field, so it's okay to leave the page to save it. All right, so we have one field in our ingredients field group, so we're going to go ahead and publish it. All right, and then once you've done that, when you go to the posts, you'll notice on the right side here, there's a box called ingredients with a text area, and that's the box that we just created. Now, getting this to display in your theme is a little bit trickier than just adding a field somewhere. You actually have to go into the template and edit it. But if you go to, I wanted to show you, there's some pretty good documentation for this plugin. Some of it's confusing and it's not written in the best of English. But you can get detailed information here. It's advancedcustomfields.com, and that's the name of the plugin. But it explains about all the different field types that you can use. There's text area, WYSIWYG editor. So this is a way where you can add like another WYSIWYG editor to your page by using this plugin. So it gives you details about all of that. And the thing that I wanted to show you in here is when you click on one of these, it gives you the template tag that you can use in your template. Just scroll down here, there's the edit screen, and there's the tag that you're going to put in your template. So it's just the field and then the name of the field right there. And let me see. Here's an example of, let's see, content single where we've edited it. And then we've just listed in here the page key, the field, and then ingredients. So now that will show up in the single. I'm going to show you what that looks like. So this is the single view of this post. And then the ingredients should be listed right here. And you're not. I'm not quite sure why. The name might be different because I had practiced earlier with this. Let's see. Ingredients. The field name is the ingredients.
Not required.
function here. So once we add that to one of the posts. So this one, you can see it has the ingredients in there. And down below the edit box, what I was wanting to show you was how I was able to list, create custom posts for all of the fields on each of these. Let's see if that works. So on this side, I created a custom post type called exhibitions. That's up here, and I used the custom post type UI that I showed last week. Each one of these is an exhibition, and it has different fields associated with it. So down here, this is actually the style that is not in a box, that looks more like a form. So this is a field placement, opening date. These are all different fields. This one is actually, depending on what field type you pick, this is actually a drop-down menu. This is a date picker. That actually, when you click in there, it brings up a date picker. The image one, you just will add this, so you can actually add an image right here. So what it allows you to do is actually add the fields that would normally be just in the description field. It allows you to create fields for each separate area that you would like. And once you've uploaded the image, there will be an option to select this image. That will come up in just a second here. Select image. Now that image is considered the juxtaposed ad. There's also just plain text inputs where you can input the full URL. And what this does is on the front end of the site, it pulls all these different fields in that we've defined, that I've defined right here in the arguments. The post type is shows, the order by is menu order. Then the meta query, this array, this is pulling that up, the custom field that's in there that I've defined. This one is a drop-down box, and it actually determines the placement of whether it's going to be on the left or the right. So I've defined that here. And this is the result of what it looks like. So this whole page is just generated by, it's checking to see if there's a value for that, and if there is, it displays it. And it's doing that for all of these links here. And so then this one is linking to a file, so it just puts the URL there of the file. And it's just a really good way to add extra functionality to your custom post types. Does anyone have any questions?
I got one for you.
Okay.
How come you chose to use the plugin instead of just
I was just trying to do something really quick and dirty, and I wanted to do something as quick as I can with this little coding. There is some coding when you display it, and that's where most of the coding will come in. Yeah. But there are so many fields for this particular project. There are so many custom fields, because each one of these is its own custom field,
right,
that I thought it was best to just use a plugin to create the inputs for all of those.
Cool. Does the plugin actually give you the ability to export that?
It does. There's. It does under settings. I haven't actually used it, but I saw that there was an option to export your settings and then import them.
Cool.
So you could transfer those from site to site.
Well, not really export, but actually export it into actual code that you can then just drop into your functions file and don't have to use the plugin. Kind of like I think the one you use to create the custom post types does that, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Then you can export it off, then you don't have to import the actual, install the actual plugin after you configure it.
Yeah, you do have to leave it plugged in, otherwise your custom fields will be removed. So that would be that's a reason why you would want to use the, code instead of using the plugin.
That still was pretty cool.
Yeah, it's very powerful. I mean, I've only really scratched the surface of what it can do. There is a repeater field, which was out of my knowledge, and using the loop, there was a lot of different things you could do with it as well. But I think that's it. I just kind of wanted to get people started in using that.
So would the repeater be something, so in the example of the recipe, you had ingredients, you could have one field that you could repeat for each ingredient?
Or? I don't know if that's what the repeater field was intended for. I think it had more to do with the loop, but I'm not super familiar with the loop and how that all worked. But that was basically it. That's all I had. Yeah. Okay.
So I'm going to talk about how to do a theme options. There's a lot of different ones out there, a lot of different frameworks. But before I do that, I'm actually going to mention another product that I use a lot that lets me set up development very quickly on a local system. It's called Desktop Server. So I'm going to run that really quickly to get started.
What is this?
Desktop server.
So that's all I need to run WordPress locally?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. It uses an XAMP.
Oh, it is.
So this is like a GUI for XAMP?
Yes. And it's actually even beyond that. It will create it'll do your WordPress install, it will put it into the Apache, everything for you.
Nice. How do we find it?
It's at desktopserver.com. And the guy who wrote this is going to be in San Diego. He's actually in San Diego, but he'll be at WordCamp.
Is that
Steven?
Yes, and he's great because you'll see him in Facebook. He answers some of the really higher technical questions.
So you're liking this? I saw you had XAMPP.
Yeah, this comes with it. It's autonomous. And I love it. It's great because I can set up a development and I'm in.
Have you ever used MAMP?
Have I used which one?
MAMP?
Yes, I had MAMP for a while.
And you like this over that?
Only because it does so much more.
Awesome.
With MAMP, you have to go ahead and set up your WordPress. You have to go ahead and go into Apache and set up the virtual domain and all that kind of stuff. This does all that for you.
How many sites can you do at one time?
Unlimited.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, there's a free version and there's like $19 for...
I think it's $49.
$49
for the unlimited. Yes, yeah. But you can get a free version. I think it lets you set up three.
Yeah. Right.
And what's really great about it, I guess we'll talk about this for a minute. In the applications folder, you can set up blueprints. So you could literally set up as many installs as you want. For example, if you wanted a bare WordPress 3.31, you can drop that in there. Or if you wanted to have it where it had all your favorite plugins, so that it loads that in with all the plugins for you. It does that for you. It sets it up. You also can go into the WP config sample and go ahead and put in any defined elements in there that you want. You can set up, if you didn't want to use the WP underscore or the database, you could enhance that with WP underscore or whatever you want so that the security is better. All that can be set up in there and it'll do that automatically for you when you get going. So you just come in, create a new development site. We're just going to call this one demo. And you can see there's a drop-down list right here. So I'm going to go ahead and just grab my Bones one, which is WordPress with Bones as the theme.
Sweet.
So right now it's loading up WordPress, it's creating the virtual host, putting the entry in.
Is it only from the internet or locally you get everything stored for that? Or?
Locally, all in your system.
So where do the files come from for WordPress?
When you install it, you put it into the blueprints directory. So you.
And you can create as many blueprints as you want.
As many as you want.
Right.
Yeah.
So when you created a blueprint for phones, is that what you're saying?
Yes, I added to, so I put in WordPress 3.31, and then in the themes folder, I went ahead and put phones.
And WordPress plus phones.
So Greg, you use this instead of MAMP or XAMPP?
Yes, instead of.
Instead of.
And then he does make it for both Mac and PC. So it can be used for both.
What?
So I just activated it. You can see I just went ahead and chose Bones as a theme because we don't have any kind of theme options over to the left. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight is how we can go ahead and add theme options. And the one I'm kind of partial to, there are at least about a dozen of them out there. They kind of all have their pluses and minuses to them. But the one I like right now is called Slighty Modded. And you can get it off of Aqua Graphite. And they actually have a video, so you can actually go on and watch and see what how to do it. But if you go down at the very bottom, it'll say download it from GitHub, so we're going to do that right now. To activate this theme options, you come into your functions file. And then on that page, scroll down the page here. They give you the code to drop right into your functions. Settings that you have, but just to show you all the different types of fields, they do have like a media uploader. One of the new features that I really like is you can actually do home page layout where you can disable and enable different blocks of types of blocks to be able to drag back and forth that you want on like a home page, which would be perfect for that.
Can you do this to anything?
Say that again?
Can you do this to anything?
Anything. Yep. It has the slider option where you could actually, if you have a slider that you want to work with and be able to sort it, you can do that with, it has a function for that. Let's see if we show some other examples. Typography, you can set up a typography type. Borders, there's a color picker built in. Text, checkboxes, multi-checkboxes. All kinds.
updated. The base theme gets updated, does this get modified?
It would not affect the, it would not affect.
It's almost like a child.
Yes. It sits in the admin folder, so it's not going to get overridden.
So is this overriding the theme's original settings?
No. We're going to have to go into, with custom field, we're going to have to go back into the code and actually write some entries that this will go ahead and take effect on. So let's take a look at that. So in the admin file, there is going to be a theme options PHP, which is what they include. And this is where you can come in, and this is where you can start styling the different types of fields that you want. If you come down to here, there will be an array. And you can almost basically cut and paste the things that you need. So an example would be, a lot of people like to have their phone number up in the right corner. And if you want to make that available to your client to be able to change anytime they want to, you could add that in your theme options. So you could do something like where up here at the top it says OF option equals array name equals home settings, and you'll notice it says type heading. If that's what creates that field, let's go back and look at that for a minute. So these fields right along the sides here, this home setting, general settings, that's how that's being created. Is by giving it a type of heading. And so then the next one down, you'll see it says the same thing, but this one here, it says hello there, and it says description, and it's got a type of info that is creating this box right here. So every time you want to create something, all you're doing is go ahead and creating an OF equals options equals array, and then you can assign the different things to it, a name, a description, an ID, you can have a default to go into it, and then the type. Now, just to show you some other uses. This theme here is actually using it. So you can see here, he's using enable a blog style, he's got a home page where he's dragging and dropping. He's actually using another really great thing that you see a lot now is social buttons. He's actually created a tab for that to go ahead and put in all the links. And then how this gets displayed is at the very top of your form, your file, it'll say global dollar data. And then the dollar data is pulled based on the ID. So for example, let's look at right here, the favicon. You'll see right here it's saying if empty data custom favicon. So in his theme options, do you see it best? There it is right here. So there's the ID custom favicon, and that's how that's getting pulled into the header. So it's really easy. Does anyone have any questions?
So this is the header from the bulk scene?
Of Office.
Office, okay.
So Greg, a lot of themes come with these options already built into the theme.
Yes.
Could this be used to add to that?
You would have to replace their
entirely.
Yeah. So I have actually done that often because I don't like some of the frameworks that they have. If they get overly not looking like WordPress anymore, they've done this, all this custom styling to it. Sometimes I'll pull it out and put in something like this. And most of them do work this way, where we're seeing you've got an array and you fill that out, so they all work very similar. Some of them do use XML, but they all work in a situation where you pick something and you assign a type to it. So those types help you decide what kind of elements that you want to create and use.
In your theme, where you're calling out, where you're basically outputting all that stuff in the theme framework, is that code that they're giving you, or is that something you're creating?
That's the code they give you.
Okay. There's some security stuff that you need to watch out for when you're taking that stuff out. You want to make sure whenever you're echoing stuff like that, you have to escape it. Because if your user puts in some HTML or Word's JavaScript, then you can have some problems.
He mentions about that in the lower part of the code about doing some escaping.
Okay.
Database, get some data out. and I need to throw that over to an HTML page, and that tells you what it looks like, and then JavaScript plays with it and makes it dynamic and does the jazz hands on the web page. What localized script does in WordPress in particular is that you can actually take stuff from PHP, so your variables, and you can throw them into your JavaScript files, which can be super handy when you're dealing with things. So let's say you needed like user information, you need to alert, you know, you want to address them by name and say, hey, Brandon, you're doing this wrong. And you want to call him Brandon specifically. Because he's logged in, you can grab that out of PHP, throw it into the JavaScript file, and throw a JavaScript alert. And then we do that. Okay, so our first topic, the registering and on-tuning script. These are the functions we're going to deal with or use. The most important one that I want you to remember is the WP register script, singular, which I point at the singular because there is an action that's plural, which we're also going to use. So the register gets the script ready. Now, it doesn't actually load it into the site yet, it just prepares everything to happen. Which does seem like an extraneous step, like why not just load it in? But we don't, this is the way we do it. You can also deregister scripts, so if something is registered and you don't want it, you can undo it after the fact. On cue script is when we do tell WordPress or the theme or the plugin, go ahead and load in this file, ready for it now. And then you can undo that as well. Although, I will say, I've never actually used this function before. So if you have, I don't know, have you ever used it yet?
Nope.
See, you're not going to do that. But just know that it exists. Okay. Seems to be a slight delay. Okay, so the most important one. So again, this is going to be the most important part of registering a script for your theme, plugin, whatever you're doing. The description, this comes from the codex. This is a safe way of registering a JavaScript, not the malicious evil way, which I suppose is a way to do that. Yeah, you can hard code a JavaScript right into your header file. Don't ever do that. That would be an unsafe way of doing it. Not unsafe. Uncool. So with the scripts, the function takes in these five arguments. The handle is what we're going to call the script. And it's handle like a trucker handle, like a CD handle. And you can call whatever you want, give it fun names. I do. There's a bunch of things. Source is obviously the source of the file. Where is this thing coming from? And that can be internal to your theme or your plugin. You can be getting it from a CDN. You can get it from like Amazon or Google APIs has a lot of JavaScript libraries that you can pull things from. Dependencies can be very important. So if you're big on using the JavaScript UI library, so maybe you're big into doing slides like accordion or drag and drop, raise your hands, who's totally into the JavaScript UI library? 1, 2.5. Okay. Those scripts depend on each other. So to use the JavaScript UI accordion script, you have to have a JavaScript UI core file installed. And the dependencies is a way to say, make sure this other one's installed before you start loading this one, and otherwise everything goes crazy. The version number is the version of that JavaScript library, which when it's your own custom code is not terribly important. But if it's jQuery, which is extremely important, what goes on in WordPress all the time, you do want to put that number in. Another thing that's good about the version variable, if you have W3 total cache running or any sort of caching running, and you change the JavaScript, but it's not loading it in, it's drafting it out. Sometimes changing that version number will make the server think, oh, this is a new file now, so it will load it up, so that can be a handy tip. And then the last one, in footer, is whether or not to load the JavaScript in the footer. Which the reasons for that, so again, when we're loading in our pages, JavaScript files are usually the big Achilles heel of loading a web page. So images and HTML templates, Browser can load this in, no problem. It can do that 2, 3, 4, 5 images at a time. It doesn't care. For some reason, when it gets through JavaScript files, okay, I'm loading this JavaScript file. Okay, it's done. And now this JavaScript file, and it's done. And it takes a long time to give 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 JavaScript files, which a lot of times WordPress themes do. So the benefit of putting it in the footer is you can load everything else, and a lot of times JavaScript isn't necessary until someone starts clicking on things or hovering over things and stuff like that. So you can wait until it gets to the end of the page and then start loading this stuff in. But in the meantime, show them the graphics and don't make them sit there and wait for anything. This is broken or the worst design I've ever seen. So the process. So this is how we load things in. Three-pronged process, a three-pronged attack. First, we use, and hopefully many of you saw the actions and filters little thing I gave back in October. Because we have to use actions. And specifically, when you're onqueuing and registering scripts, you want to use the WP onqueue scripts plural action to load the scripts in. The reason for that being, theoretically, you can load your scripts at any time. It's usually pretty clever about knowing. If I'm WordPress and I say, yeah, I know you said you wanted to load in this JavaScript, but you said it way back here, and you shouldn't have, but I remember that, I'll do it when it's the right time, so don't worry about it. If you do it there, again, it's kind of convention. One, that's when WordPress is ready to start accepting JavaScript, so that's the best time to do it. Two, if there's a lot of JavaScript action going on, and there almost always is in WordPress, if everybody's doing it at the same time, WordPress can be much smarter about, okay, this script depends on that script. Oh, wait, you said deregister this script here, and you said onqueue this one here, and it just gets organized much better and much faster. So always in that action. The next thing we want to do is we want to register the script with our register function, which we went over. And then finally, we want to onqueue the script. So we want to say, get ready to use this file, don't use it yet, and say, okay, we're going to use that file. Generally this will be done in your functions.php file. But not necessarily, so you can do it in a plugins file somewhere, you can do it specifically in a theme template file maybe. And I'll go over the reasons for that in just a moment. I know we didn't go over the structure for this function yet, but it's super easy, so don't worry. Just one argument. So, for example, what are we even doing here? Okay, so let's say we have our WordPress install. WP content is our themes. The custom theme I made, IVG. In there, I made a JavaScript folder, and then way over the end, I have custom.js, I think it's called again, too. And that's what I want to load into my theme. Oh, yeah, we're going to talk. Had I only read, always read the instructions first. So we load a custom.js from my themes JS folder, and it doesn't have to be a JS folder, you can call your JavaScript folder whatever you would like. Or you don't even have a folder, just be floating in your folder, that's fine too. So that's what we're loading in. So using our three-pronged attack, so pretend this is our functions.php page right here. So we start with our actions, which is the WP onqueue scripts. And
is everybody familiar with actions?
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So this is the action. This is our custom function, custom onqueue scripts. And then we write that function here. So custom onqueue scripts. First, usually I actually put the source right in, but
it was wrapping and it looked funny, so I made a variable for it.
So get underscore style sheet, underscore directory, underscore URI is the same as doing get blog info style sheet director, I think is the way we used to do it, and now they're saying use these little functions instead. I don't really know the reason they changed that, but a lot of the get blog info things are all functions now. And there's a library in somewhere, but I don't know what it is.
So anyway, this is saying up to our style sheet directory /js/custom.js. Now I register the script. So first I gave him a little handle, and again, I could call it breaker or whatever, if I call it custom script. Then, this is the file that I'm loading in. The dependency
dependencies, so the script I'm using has to have jQuery already loaded in, so I have a dependency of jQuery. If you have multiple things, this can come in as an array, so you can do jQuery, comma, jQuery, UI, slash, whatever else you need. Version number, again, this is my own little script, so I gave it version 1, you can give it a 0.1, whatever you like. And then in the footer, getNet.
Now, one thing I will say about
Jeff,
the...
Yes. If you put the dependency for jQuery in there, is that going to force jQuery to load at that point?
Yes. So it'll wait till jQuery loads and then loads this one.
Cool.
Yeah. And jQuery is not included. Actually, I don't know what happens. So if you don't actually have to.
It's always
included. Well, I know jQuery, but I'm saying if the dependency that you put in there isn't included, then.
Like Scriptaculous.
No, that's one that's in there. It's in the library as well. One of these 70, one being so one thing very important about being loading the footer is your theme has to have a WP underscore footer function in there somewhere. Otherwise, it'll load it in head because it says, I don't know where your footer is because you never put that function in. So that's just a side thing. Although I've never seen a theme without it, so shouldn't be a problem. So this is what I'm telling WordPress. Get ready to use this, because I'm going to use it later. Probably going to use it later. I don't have to. But get ready to use it. Get ready to use custom script. Get ready to use Gregg Burger. So then, I said, okay, yeah, I want to use it now. And I know I did it right after. And it is good practice, even though you could have just loaded it in right here. Do one and then the other. So as soon as I do this, it'll load in my custom script. Yes, sir.
So what is the difference between doing it that way or just doing the NQ script instead of NQ scripts?
Okay.
So because I know you can basically still pull in the script and make it work just by using the third function. There.
Yes. You can. So again, you could do all of this in this function.
Right.
And you can do it outside of the action.
Right.
So in your function, you can just do this.
Yeah, you just do the WP NQ script and put in the variables in there.
Right.
What is the difference?
It's uncool.
So you want to be a hacker. You don't want to be just a regular programmer, right?
Right.
Okay. That's one reason. It looks better. You get the JavaScript. So part of the reason is again, trying to get all your JavaScript action to come in during this action. Trying to get all your JavaScript stuff to come in during this action. Because again, if you're doing it at that time and everyone else is doing it at that time, it gets handled much better. Especially if you're registering and deregistering and unqueuing and unqueuing or dequeuing things.
So if I had two different scripts, I would actually make one action and put both of the scripts in there.
Yes. Okay. You can put a bunch in there if you wanted to. The other thing that's nice too is, you can register your scripts like in your functions page. And then maybe in your templates is when you need to call them in, because maybe you only, this custom script, maybe I only use it on archive pages and author pages. And so on those template pages, then I can put this in on those template pages. Or I can put a conditional on here and say, oh no. That's not what you would say. You gotta use a conditional statement. And again, maybe some other plugin or something else wants to use this registered script as well. So rather than doing the on queue and having to figure out all the variables again, all the parameters again, it's a nice clean way. This is not, you can do it the other way.
But that's a better way to do it because then it actually puts the scripts into the right order and it plays nicer with WordPress and other things.
You have a better chance of everything working right, especially when you're using a lot of JavaScript. If you're doing just one, you can get away with either. Again, this is just kind of convention, so it's better to stick with what everyone else is doing.
You can do multiple scripts inside of the one action statement that you're doing.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, you would want to do all of your JavaScript inside of this one action.
You register and queue them both inside. So if I have two scripts, I create one add action, and then do one register and one queue for one of them, and then another register and queue for the other one.
Correct. Okay. Any other questions yet? This
one. Isn't it actually, but part of the safety part of it, isn't it actually sort of comparing the other functions that have been loaded so it doesn't you don't, it eliminates some JavaScript crashing.
Yeah, so you have a better chance of everything working succinctly, like you expected it to. Again, it's very WordPress is very good at figuring out what you meant. But it's always better to tell it clearly what you meant. So number two, so let's say you wanted the same thing, but you only wanted the single load the pages. So you can put conditionals around the same. And again, we could put this on a template page or a plugin page, something like that. But feel free to make this conditional. So, and the reason for this being, don't load the script in if you're not going to use it, because again, that's one extra JavaScript that's getting loaded in and taking up load time. So don't bother. Okay. So again, the available libraries that are already, these are things that are already registered. So they've already done a WP register script. And these are just some examples that I know are popular. Let's say there's 64 others, and there's a URL that you can't really read here. But it's in the code. It's with WP IP script function codex page will have the whole list. And again, it's like 70 some things. But Scriptaculous root, all the other Scriptaculous sub pages you can call in. And if you did, so let's say you wanted the Swift upload script because you can use that in your theme. You don't have to bother with the register because it's already registered through WordPress. All you do is do the WP script and the handle is Swift upload. The handle is very intuitive. It's usually just the script's name all lowercase with that. And so again, if you're using the accordion or the date picker is a very popular one. The color picker is in there. All the UI tools are in there. Other stuff, I don't know. Go look around. But again, the point of this being, if you're going to load a script in that you don't think is installed on WordPress, go and check in here first, because it might already be, so don't do something twice when you're going to do it. So example three. For example, let's say we wanted to use the Swift upload and the thick box. We wouldn't need to register those because they're already registered through WordPress. We just say on queue Swift upload and on queue thick box. And again, you can do both in the same action. We did the JavaScript scripts. I saw it twice. Very easy. And I'm very excited about making the register for these next commission point. Any questions yet? Yes.
So is it good to, like, good practice to dequeue, deregister all of them at the beginning and then go through and re-register them all after, or just to make sure it's a clean slate? Or
you would only dequeue or deregister them if you specifically did not want them in there. Just registering them really doesn't take up any load time.
Okay.
So it's just saying, just like you're telling me, I'm probably going to use jQuery. And
right.
You go, okay, cool. And then Todd says, okay, we're going to use jQuery. You go, okay, let me go get the jQuery library. Then it takes some time.
What about the versioning of the, between, if you say like one version's already loaded and now you have another version, is it?
Yes, it is an issue.
Okay. I know if that's like your next slide or whatever.
So example number four.
Cool.
Nice setup.
Yeah, man.
He's a plan. I give him $5. So let's say we want to load jQuery from an external source. So this again, jQuery is something that's already registered and probably already loaded. So in the same action that keep using, first we say deregister the jQuery. Then we say on hold from the Google APIs. And again, this is where you do have to be very careful of what version you're using, because WordPress requires a minimum level of jQuery. Or what is that right now? Anybody?
1.63?
That sounds good. 1.63, 1.64-ish. I'm not very sure how it takes. So you want to make sure that you can at least handle WordPress. It may be different for, maybe there's a plugin or something you're using and it's a higher version. I don't know why I picked 1.71 here, but I did. So then you re-register. So we deregister jQuery. Now we're re-registering it to this new source. It doesn't have any dependencies. I'm giving you the version 1.71. I definitely don't want to load this in the footer. You need that right away. It's a lot of things depend on it. And then we on to jQuery. Now, again, this is kind of what spawned Brandon and I to talk about doing this presentation in the first place. So we have client who has a site, has a huge high traffic site. And the guy at the hosting company figured out that just for loading jQuery alone, she was paying, I think it was $9 a month. Which doesn't sound like a lot.
$3 a day.
$9 a day, was it?
$3 a day.
$3 a day. I don't know my facts right. but it was significant.
Which is about $90 a month.
Yeah, which is ridiculous for loading jQuery. So we went over to Google and we made that before. So the lower bills and we look at euros. That's awesome. Plus the other thing is nice is now this is loading from another site, so we can load this and another JavaScript at the same time as it comes from different sources. So it made the load time faster and cheaper.
So would you suggest do that every time on every site?
I do now. I haven't found a reason. Well, okay, so the downfall of this is that goes down to that late changes for some reason. Then all the site obviously goes
right.
Yeah, but if Google goes down, the whole internet's down.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
which is the internet now. It's for Facebook.
Another thing about the external thing. So also be careful of if you're doing like an e-commerce site or anything where you have an HTTPS situation, sometimes these external ones don't handle SSL connections. I don't think the Google one does, but I think the Microsoft one does. If you go to jQuery.whatever the site is,
Google one does handle SSL.
Hold on, let me write that down. Could you check if that's up beforehand?
Yeah, you could run this link in the browser. And if
no, I mean like.
I think you can do it. Sure. I know what he's
saying. Oh, this, yeah, yeah.
You can check, say, and if right. It's not available, you can go to your local.
Yes. Yeah, so that's a very good solution too. Unless the problem is WordPress is loading, you know, version 1.6.3 or 4, we don't really know, and you needed 1.7.1, then that fallback's not going to help the situation. But yes, you can say, does this script, is it valid right now? If so, use it. If not, use the fallback. Oh, yes! Good, I put notes in for myself. So if you deregister something important like jQuery, when you re-register, don't call it other jQuery or something else, because there's things that are using jQuery as a dependency. So if you call something else, everything else that says, I need jQuery as a dependency, is going to go, no, that doesn't exist anymore. We have this jQuery other instead. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't know. Again, WordPress is good at knowing what you meant, but that's too much. And be careful with version number. My highlight is fantastic. Clearly, what I meant is shown in that graphic. Okay, so now, this one's getting crazy. Now you're running the thinking caps. So, WP localized script. So, this is when we're taking stuff from PHP and throwing it into a JavaScript file, right? Which really comes in handy. So, a function called WP localized script. Handle is referring to whatever handle we call the script that we registered it. Object underscore name is what we're going to call the object when it's in JavaScript. We're going to use that. And then the localization. And I learned this today, but it's driving me nuts. So the L10 in and L18 in, which you see sometimes, and I had no idea why they use that. Why do they use that? It doesn't make sense.
It's easy.
Are you
hacking
me?
No, I was just.
What's going on?
L10N is easier to type.
I'm sorry, what?
L10N is easier to type.
It is. So, but what does it mean? For is localization and
internationalization,
right? So, internationalization, I 18 characters between N, so I 18N, and localization L 10 characters. That's all it is. It's coders being super lazy. And I was too lazy to actually go figure out what it meant, I didn't share. Until today, someone's going to ask me, what does that even mean? So, let's wait.
What happened? It's not updating.
I'm on the next page, it's thinking about it. Mm-hmm. Sorry, is there like a motion sensor thing? Do I need a dance card number?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. No, all I know is
dancing. Dancing is always
ways to answer. Absolutely. And, that's my closer. I'm moonwalk out of here. With jazz hands.
Oh, with jazz hands.
Oh, it's all about the jazz hands.
Did it go?
Okay, I apologize for the very brief. This is a WP Live script. So, a lot of this is everything you've seen already. So this is the customized script that we keep customizing. Now I take an array of data, and I say, again, you get variables. What are the variables you need for PHP? I was trying to think of things that are unique that you get from PHP that I would want to put in JavaScript. And what I came up with was user ID, for example. It could be anything, I don't know. And it's not that I haven't used it in the past, I have, it's been a good example. So then, to take user ID and first name, throw them into a JavaScript file, and say, hey, we look like script. Okay, which script? This is customized script that I got you. Always do this after the on queue, so don't do this first and then on queue. Okay, this, I don't know what you're talking about. I haven't seen that script yet. User info, user store info is going to be the object name in JavaScript, and then the data I want to send over. Okay, now the caveat to this is that there's also a JavaScript portion that you have. So remember, up on top is what we've done with our data and our WP lookalike script. So in my custom script, I said alert 8, and then again, user store info is the object name, and then the variable that I called it, which is fname. And I could have used user UID if I wanted to. So a JavaScript alert would come up and say, hey, Jeff, or whoever is logged in. On example 6.
Let's do it all, right?
Slow the same line up. So here again, we're doing two scripts in that same action. So I want my jQuery from somewhere else, and then I want to load in this custom script. In that custom script, I want to throw in all this extra data. And I didn't actually make these variables, I just already do it again. And then for cafe and LA. I'll get into that. But let me show you in a live example here. Yeah, it's going to be crazy. Sorry, one more thing on that. I thought this was going to be the big extravaganza. This is like when all the fireworks are going off at once. And I forgot to light the fuse. So the important thing here is notice that I kept on the if is page right here. So in this example, if I go to a page, it loaded up jQuery and then it gave me this alert and I said, hey, and again I said first name, Jeff, and then I used my last name there, which was more slick. So if I'm a web user, I'm going to be blown up. Jeez. This is like the Matrix.
In case you forgot.
Yeah. In case I forgot who I was. Who? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's me. If we go to the like, categories page here, no JavaScript, because I said only on if is page.
So the conditional name.
Can we go back to the page?
Fancy.
I know, right? I was excited about it.
This is when dancing should ensue.
Yeah.
I can't even coordinate that. But it's like behind the podium, so. But it's on video now, so.
About that
but the podium, if I stand sideways,
work
this way.
Just your legs.
I work in profile. Here, let's go back to. I think I might have not. Yes. Are there any questions? All that madness. Is everybody ready to put JavaScript into the themes and/or plugins now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are there any questions? I'm sorry.
So what was the, did you already say the thing, the reason why you figured it out?
Yes, the reason why it was we had that client that was, they're paying how many dollars a day just to look at the jQuery. We said, that can't be, we can fix that. And we did. Okay. Any other questions? I know, it's not actually funny, it's just interesting.
Which is why it wasn't memorable.
No, it made a lot of sense.
Yeah.
That's a reason for it.
You might have a question. Okay, that was all I had.
Tell us your name.
My name is Anton Vasilescu. I'm mostly a designer. Started dabbling in development lately and learning a lot about that stuff. So this is the backend of the theme. Actually, once you install it, you have a little tab up and top of everything, and you have all the settings here. The quick setup tab actually goes through all the changes that you need to do to get it up and run.
Is it a single theme?
It's a single. What do you mean?
A single.
It's a single theme. Yes, you install just one theme, but it has different designs, different templates inside, and that's where I'm to go. It has the choose theme, and basically, it comes in with all these different designs that you can pick from. And the way you work with it, you just choose one of these, you apply it to your site, and then you go into the other options in there, and I'm going to show you next. Basically, you change and customize everything in there. We have a CSS editor, basically. So you choose one of the things for both of these sites that I've shown. I started from this black one here. It's pretty simple. They wanted the logo on the top left, the navigation on top right, and kind of like from there, I just changed everything. The nice part about the theme is that it has a built-in basic e-commerce little store, and it also has a image gallery that's really easy to customize and edit and add images to it and modify them. It works pretty flawlessly now. So basically in here you have global settings. We can go change background colors, background images, do all this stuff for the background. Then what was it? It even allows you to put music that plays in the background.
Oh.
It's optional. Sorry?
No, I'm just like interrupting you. Sorry.
So let's go to the global settings. Now for the header, you can add logo and all that stuff. It has different templates, so it's really easy for a non-developer to go and change everything and make it the way they want it. And then, again, change colors. It has a lot of fonts already built in, so you can just choose the font that you want, and it's gonna update and it's gonna display. Again, colors, fonts, for everything. That was for the navigation. Now, for the body, the same way, you can change colors, font styles, font sizes, everything on the headers are in there that you can change. Links, everything can be set up really from here. Then for the sidebar, you can choose, it's not a responsive theme, so, but you can choose percentage-wise how big the sidebar and the content areas are going to be. And again, change fonts, everything. It already has those Twitter icons built in, so you can just click one of the styles, add new information. It's going to display them. And the same for the footer. Again, you can change your styles, change text, change the height. So basically, those are the basic settings. Once you're done with those settings, you can you have the gallery settings. And in the gallery settings, okay, in the gallery settings, you can choose how big the actual gallery is going to be when it's getting embedded, the style of it, again, kind of different transitions between the images, and you can add captions over the images. A lot of settings, and the beauty is that it's all in here. You don't have to look anywhere for it. So it's really good for quick websites. Then again, like I said, it has a little e-commerce store built in. It's not as powerful, and it's designed for basically for photographers that want to sell prints. And it allows you to choose different sizes. And basically, it's designed just for digital products. And which, you know, because you can order prints from the photographer. That's what one of the websites does. So it's been a while since I touched this. I wanted to do the presentation like Jeff said, like Steve said, about 8 months ago. So okay. So it integrates really easy with PayPal. It's really simple. And now this is the part that I like the most about it. The other option. You can add Google Analytics. That's not a big deal, but in here you have a CSS code that you can actually add. And actually, in here, I've got all the changes to transform these two websites to make it look like this. And just the other one, which is a little bit different. And so all was run in this CSS area here. So I thought this is really powerful for non developers. And that's about it. Really.
Did you have to make the on the other one, the Sig Art Inc., the placement of the thumbnails, the thumbnail right. browser below? Did you do that in CSS?
Basically, it comes like this
okay.
to their own CSS, and for this one, I've removed them.
Got it.
And I've changed a little bit on the theme.
So did you do that within the theme itself, or is there
yes.
a way to do that in the back end?
I did it through the CSS.
Oh, okay.
I just put display on.
Oh, okay.
I just hit it all down.
Sure.
So how much does it cost?
What? The theme? I think it's $80. So.
$89 according to the website.
Is it $89? I thought it's well worth for. Because you're able to get a website for somebody in a few hours.
Does it use the gallery that's the WordPress gallery to do?
It's, no, it has their own gallery. Sorry. Has it built in? Because I thought that was quite amazing the way they've integrated it. So you have that little link up there that adds a new theme, and once it adds it right underneath the main content area, and when you go into edit gallery, basically you can choose what type of gallery do you want, kind of like different thumbnails, film strip, slideshow, and then choose the height, and then upload your images. And you can also kind of drag and drop to rearrange your images, and all this gets saved. And it's basically once you save the gallery, everything is shown out there.
Can it create a gallery from a category of posts?
No. You can just add. It's it's not that open. Basically, the gallery you just add it to the post, mm-hmm. and then you upload your images, and that's it. Or at least
so
that was my experience with it.
The image slider on the homepage of Sig Art Gallery, was that a gallery or was that pulling in?
That's one gallery. I just created that gallery in the homepage.
and I've added to the home page.
Makes sense, okay.
So.
But you can have multiple galleries?
Yes, you can have multiple galleries. I think you can even have multiple galleries on the same page.
Oh.
So.
Can you add videos on this?
I've added videos, but I've added them here. But I've added them to a plugin. Oh, it's actually the clients didn't have all their legal stuff in kind of that's in their own, and they did just photography, so they didn't want to put them out there without the kind of like the concept of the music and all the videos. So, but basically, I use the plugin. I don't remember the name of it right now. You know what? But I can find it and I can post it on Facebook. Yeah. So. Yeah, so that's basically it. I thought it's really powerful for really quick websites. Any questions? Oh, great. Yay!
There's actually a lot of new faces in the room, and we skipped this at the beginning because a lot of people were a little bit late. So I wanted to take this opportunity to go around the room and have everybody introduce themselves. And just talk briefly about what you're doing in WordPress. And we're going to start here.
My name is Grayson. I'm actually fairly new to WordPress, but I find what you guys do pretty fascinating. I work in our family street sweeping business, and we're currently undergoing a complete site overhaul from a static HTML site to WordPress. So just trying to find out what sort of options are out there and the direction that we should be going.
Hi everybody, my name is Juan Gallardo. I write content for DeVry University. We have our blog that runs on WordPress, and I also do web design on my own.
Juan attends SMMOC regularly as well. Any other people from SMMOC in the room, raise your hand. If you're not familiar with SMMOC, I'll explain it after announcements.
I'm Ben Loba, and I'm one of the Seattle organizers, and I'm just out hanging down here with my aunt for a couple months. Thought I'd drive by.
I'm Dave. I'm a software engineer, web developer, and WordPress geek.
I'm Jason Tucker. I'm a web developer now. I recently lost my job, so I'm switching over to doing WordPress development full-time now.
I'm Faye Reed, and I'm a WordPress developer, and I also do, can I say that now?
Yeah.
Okay. I also do business consulting for the Small Business Development Center. Some of you may have heard of it, I'm not sure if you do. But we are, people come to us and we help them for free with limited WordPress sites and that sort of a thing, but we have a lot of clients who come in who want custom sites that we can't do under the way that we operate. So I'm putting together a list of WordPress developers in Orange and LA County who we can basically, we can't recommend one certain WordPress developer to these clients, so we have to give them basically a list of people and then they can choose from. So I'm putting together a list of WordPress developers in the region, and if you want to be on it, I will be posting apparently on, there's a Facebook group also, but if you are interested in being on the list, let me know after this and I'll make a little
Excel. Raise your hand if you're a WordPress developer.
Yeah.
Done.
Come see me after
that.
We'll come back around to Suzette.
You spoke earlier. Okay. I'm Suzette. Hi. I'm a WordPress developer. Been for about 2 years, 2.5 years, and I've been doing web for about 15.
Gregg Franklin out in the Inland Empire area, WordPress developer.
Robert Griffin, just learning about WordPress. I have a meetup that I want to build, same group off meetup for social mixing and having problems with developers, so I was trying to learn as much as I can on my own.
You have any problems with developers?
You're so social.
Beer and pizza fixes all.
Don't let the dark.
My name is Trishida Ahmed. I'm just here to
My name is Dave. I work for Religion News LLC, a journalism organization. I work in WordPress there about half the time, and I build WordPress sites on my own some of the time.
My name is Art, and I build WordPress sites for my own companies.
Kat.
Me? I'm Kat, and I'm a creative online marketing professional, and I delve in a little bit of everything, WordPress included.
You're going to be jealous.
I'm Priscilla Christian, and I'm a WordPress stalker. I don't know why.
And she goes to Amanda.
Oh, God. That's her words. That's her words. I'm the Empress of Priscilla Christian Graphic Services.
WordPress.
Jeff Hester, alter ego of the SoCalHiker.net, and I build websites primarily using WordPress.
Challenge Jeff to WordPress. So kick your ass.
My name is Craig Levine, and I'm a photographer, and I shoot jazz musicians, and in the process, they won.
They should all be shot.
So, yeah, they're all poor, which is why they should be shot. But the deal is that invariably they want websites developed. So something fell in my lap on a request to take a site that works and then migrate it to one with a new branding. And so I'm a stalker. I'm looking for somebody that can give me a brain dump
to
this former Lotus Notes developer that his brain has atrophied. So this I've said that song before. So this first meeting I've been to in the last 6 months. But now I'm back in the game, and I'm solicitous to knowledge. So come see me.
Hi, I'm Linda, new to the group, and I inherited a project. I work with a nonprofit as a volunteer to redo their website. And the geeks set it up for us in WordPress, and I'm thrilled to be learning it, but I'm still learning. And I'm here to soak up information and network with people and make the website even better. It's up and running, it looks good, but I want to improve it. I also do a lot of videography and news broadcast and a lot of editing of video.
Anton Vasilescu, web developer, programmer, 3D animator, and WordPress geek.
Wes Churchill, WordPress developer, and I run crowded sites and have been around a while, and nice to be here again. So.
Hi everybody, I'm Steve Kane. I'm a freelancer, actually transitioning to a paid lancer. Brand under hand-picked tomatoes, but it's meaningless. It's hand-picked tomatoes is me, and I'm all WordPress all the time.
Where's a rim shot if you need it?
Yeah. I'm Bob Bollinger, up from Irvine, and I do sites in WordPress.
Hey, I'm Shredder. DreamHost pays me to work on WordPress.
I'm Ron Glenn. I do software training at a law firm during the day, and I mess around on one personal website for profit and a non-for-profit website for a company.
Cool.
I work for an SEO company, and I just started building WordPress websites for people who can't afford to play with big boys.
Hey.
Oh, Cindy. Sorry.
Welcome.
My name is Catherine Hatfield. I'm an oil painter, and I dabble with some WordPress.
I'm Alice. I'll tell you a little bit of my research. I was working as a mechanical drafter and technical poster. And whenever production slows down, I was out of the job. So five companies on my resume are closed. And I started in graphic design, and I do also machine embroidery. And I want to build a website for myself for embroidery, and my website for my daughter, who is an architect. And my brother, who is an architect photographer, and I want to have control over it. And I'm proud.
What are your questions?
My name is Tom. I manage my own company's website.
Big man.
I'm Lauren. I work on WordPress. I pay Drew most to host my videos.
I pay Drew most too.
They respond pretty quick.
You can get callbacks.
Last year, we're maybe moving to about 200 this year.
It's 8 o'clock.
Shh.
Remind me. Get up.
Mind you, they turn this down.
Call Google.
So, it could be any.
Right, let me use some negative space.
Yeah. keep watching on the Facebook group, but that's the first place we'll say we'll tickets are on sale, which could be any day.
Which is a good segue because San Diego sold out in less
11
than 12
hours.
Yeah. 200 tickets in less than 12 hours. As soon as they announce it, get your ticket or you won't get one.
What's the problem with the money?
And if you buy me a beer, I might sneak it in the door.
Well, that's cheap. That's cheaper than a ticket.
Wow. Okay.
You know what
a
six-pack gets you. Seattle WordCamp is when?
May 19th.
Seattle WordCamp is May 19th. Anybody go to Phoenix? Show of hands. Anybody go to Phoenix? Trader went to Phoenix. How was it?
It
was good. It was good? All right.
The video for that is already out.
Say what's
Phoenix, right? I went to Phoenix. Phoenix was rad.
Phoenix was rad.
Thank you.
The videos are already up for Phoenix.
Yes.
The videos are already up from OC 2 years ago.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. We still got some extra time, so is there anything else randomly that we want to discuss tonight?
That's right.
Oh, real quick, for those of you who are not already on it, since I have this up, There is a very active Facebook group called OC WordPress. If you're not on already, send me an email or send me a friend request, and I'll add you. This group just keeps getting better and better.
Arguably the best, I think.
Absolutely. I'm really very, very proud of this group. This group runs with the philosophy of there are no stupid questions.
No. You can ask. Is evidence by me?
What's that?
Is evidence by me?
But seriously, I mean, this group is getting more and more responsive. So any question typically gets a response within 5 minutes. I mean, this has been an excellent resource.
It's not if you're going to get an answer, it's choosing the answer you get.
Yes. Yeah. You know, there's healthy debates, there's conversation, we always bag on cat. It's good stuff. So you can take a post that's completely unrelated and bag on cat. It's a sport.
I am love.
Yes.
You want to mention something about the other group, SMMOC?
Yes, SMMOC. So, do you want to explain what SMMOC is?
Yes.
Social Media Mastermind in Orange County. So it's everybody that is not just in development, but also in social media. So if you want to learn about anything related at all, whether it's Facebook, Pinterest, Path, anything, any of the new trends coming up, any of the older sites, if you want to learn how to use them, like Twitter. It's like a roundtable discussion that we have on Saturday morning. Mm-hmm. And then the way it works is you get there, you can write whatever question you have on the board, and then we'll, as a group, just chime in and contribute.
And you can find them on meetup.com for SMMOC.
Yes.
Where are you going to meet?
In Costa Mesa.
Costa Mesa.
Meet in Costa Mesa at Cleveland Creative. Kathy and Bob often come to this group as well. So SMMOC is also a very active group. It's not as the internet's down, so I don't know what's going on. What's that? SMMOC is a very lively group. They meet for 2 hours every Saturday morning, most Saturday mornings in Costa Mesa. And they discuss, there's a little bit of WordPress, but it's more about what's going on in social media. And it's always a healthy debate.
So it's less technical and more
social
media.
But I do highly recommend going and checking it out. It's a good group to go to. I'm completely down. Anyway, so let's move into questions. Anything else we want to discuss for Dev Day? Yes.
Why is your internet down?
Do you see why we pick on Cat?
I knew why we pick on Cat.
I know you pick
on Cat. Next question. When do you think it'll be up again?
Surfing like crazy.
It's a mess.
Doesn't work on yours?
I don't know. Lauren touched my computer.
Windows 10.
You've got a poltergeist.
I don't know.
I can't, yeah.
Are there any WordPress related topics you want to discuss? Oh. Yes.
I hear a lot about the Genesis theme. What's like the big deal about it? Is it like a nice clean template to get started with?
I'm not totally experienced with Genesis. You know, some on the surface, but I'm going to open it to the group. Genesis developers in the room. Yes?
I like it because it's a very light footprint in framework form, and it does actually look pretty nice. I think it looks like fun. But even the basic Java version of it is responsive design already. So that's another head start. And it's extremely well documented. So finding answers is very
important. Lots of tutorials too.
Yeah. So that's what I think.
So there's a lot of themes even outside of the Studio Press site too that you can find free.
Yeah.
The free Genesis child themes.
So Genesis is paid or free?
Just paid. Excellent.
$60, $80?
A lot more than that.
Well, Genesis itself is like $80, and then the themes are, the pro package. The pro package is kind of expensive.
But then Sarah says, excellent SEO.
Excellent SEO.
Yes. Yes. And if you're using another SEO package, turn
it
to SEO also.
And as Alex will tell you, that multiple SEO plugins does not equal extra SEO.
But if you're a programmer, you can extend that list. There are filters and hooks for that.
Yeah, I'm hosed on the internet. I don't know what's going on. Does that answer your question?
Well, because the...
if I can get on here, I'll actually do it.
So, for example,
it's really cool.
The employer that I do that for, I can't modify anything, so I can't add plugins, I can't change the theme. So that's why I was trying to figure out, I might have to code it in there.
No, you should just be able to post the link, paste the link right into your post.
Yeah, you don't need any plugins or anything as part of WordPress.
What version of WordPress are you using?
It's an older version.
3.1?
I do off the top of my head.
I think that was about the version I started checking for.
Steve, you want to swap laptops with somebody?
You think that's causing the interference?
The easy button,
I look inside, has a corroded battery.
That's a problem.
That's not so easy. When I bought this, they had the Spanish easy button sitting next to it, and I should have picked it up. It says fácil on the front of it, and you press it, it says, es muy fácil. They don't make it anymore. On eBay, they're $80.
Oh, wow.
The Spanish easy button.
Yeah. Wow.
I should have grabbed like 20 of them. Yeah, I don't know what's going on.
I think that's blocked your Facebook access.
Probably.
I have no question.
You're good.
House of Brews is probably jamming you.
Is there anything wrong with posting your own video? Just uploading it?
No, bandwidth. That's about it.
Bandwidth is about all the only limit you're going to hit, just because the assets are so large, depending on the size of the video. Shredder can comment on that, but I'm not kidding, because I'm going to fix the internet.
Yep, that's it. And then you might end up wanting to install a plugin to like link to it, because you can't just stick the link in.
I have
an
idea.
For those sorts of things.
Well, I just give it a reboot.
Yeah, I did.
Your computer.
The element.js plugin for WordPress that lets you use a shortcode to link directly to your videos.
But if you host on YouTube or whatever, you get the extra exposure. So from a marketing standpoint, there's a benefit to hosting on the YouTube more videos, more people. Yeah, you're going to get more people. Instead of the people who are coming just to your site, you're going to get exposure to anyone on those networks.
It's expensive to host videos.
That's all right. Like, we don't charge for any bandwidth at all. So, that's
why. Yeah, we don't charge for bandwidth. There you go. If somebody has like 100 videos running on their $20.
Yeah, their policy says that as long as it's web accessible, you can have it on there. So you can put you can put anything on there as long as it's web accessible.
It's funny, right? It's cool.
I can't hear you.
Like you hear like.
Absolutely. Is it possible in WordPress to create custom whatever CSS or whatever it is to develop, like where people can post their own videos? Like, do you know what I mean? Like,
yes.
So, like, you're on your YouTube site? You know, people can upload videos? Is that true?
It's not a YouTube site, but it's something similar to it. Like
right down there.
You know,
there you go.
People come and they can post their own, create their own videos if they want to. Like, providing them, it's easy, like, instead of bringing them from YouTube or.
And I do the same thing,
Steve.
They can
do that. Is that possible? It's
easier than the video.
No, but she doesn't want to agree with me too. You want to create a site so they can create their own video.
Yes, and like, say for example, you know, like somebody wants to talk about WordPress. It's like they might have posted something on YouTube, if they can just create it, like maybe the whole segment on WordPress, like 10 or 12 tutorials on WordPress and create it in WordPress form.
Not sure if I understand.
Say if I have a site, it's an educational site. So if, say for example, if somebody who has a very good tutorial on WordPress, how can they post those 12?
I'm about to show.
Oh,
I'm about to do that. Yeah, that's why I wanted to get this working so I could show. What Juan was asking is if I have a video that I want to embed and post, as long as you're using the latest version of WordPress 3 Creator. You don't have to do any tricky short codes or plugins or anything anymore if you're just using some of the standard video services. So all I'm doing is just plugging in the URL of my YouTube video into the body of the post. Okay. Let's publish this. Yes.
Does it matter, or is it only my error on this one, so I'm not picking on Steve, that it's just the text of the URL, not the actual hyperlink? Switch over to the HTML.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just the text in the URL.
Yes.
I saw somebody do it before, and I thought it was maybe actually I did it. Somebody else did it too, but I was just trying to.
Just as long as you've got this format of the URL in there, it's gonna
detect it. If you copy out of the address bar, it pulls in the AHR text. Right.
I don't
get
that.
No. I think so.
So it's a Windows. So.
Did you use
94? I'm going to do this post. Oops.
Page not found.
Sexy.
What did I do wrong? Oh.
Need a title?
There it is. As long as you just put in that standard URL format, it's going to pull in this code for it. It's going to own that, is what this is. So, it works with YouTube, Vimeo, Blip. I forget the ones that are in there. It's on a codec somewhere as to which ones are supported. Actually, let's look while I was talking about it.
Below the title, you put in test hyphen video or video. What was that field that you explicitly put in?
Permalink.
Who's editing the permalink?
What's the need? What's
per? It was just have it.
So if you leave it empty, it's still going
to
apply?
You want to leave it empty. It needs to be something. It won't let you leave it empty. It needs to be something. But I just matched the title that was in
there. And the purpose of the permalink?
The purpose of the
SEO.
Is for SEO purposes.
Yeah.
It's the permanent link to that post or
page. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. These are the video services that are supported. I just did a search for OMBED on the codex, and those are the ones that are built into WordPress, and they can be extended, according to Dave. I don't know. He usually is.
I don't know why.
No, they can be extended. So actually, there's quite a few of them that are in there.
That's reminded me of the last one.
What's that?
Steve, if you scroll down a page, it talks about it.
That's what the new Twitter.
For some Twitter video?
The
embedded tweet.
Yeah.
Yes. Gotcha. What did you want to look at there?
No, that's the register right there.
Adding more.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Dave didn't mind this time.
System.
Okay. Make sense?
Yes.
Cool. Does that help?
Yeah, it does, but I still have, for example, if someone wants to come and post in there, they have, because this one would be only performed by the administrators.
Right.
But can I leave it open for the users, for everybody to
I think you're looking for something along the lines of Gravity Forms. Gravity Forms that let you user submit content. It sounds to me like that's what you're looking for, is some user submitted content.
You want somebody to come to your site and submit a post for review.
You want Tumblr.
You need either Gravity Forms or VoiceTalk, which is really awesome. Mm-hmm. But there's other ways to do it. You can also give somebody, subscribe to the site and give them the right permissions where they can get to the dashboard and actually write a post, but it doesn't go live, goes pending. But I would use Gravity Forms instead, because now that it exists, like, where you don't have to give somebody an account. They can just kind of fill out the form, type their subject, type their stuff, the URL in there, and submit.
And it would be, as soon as they submit, would that go live?
No, because you don't want it to do that. You don't want it to go live. You want it to actually go to the status. Then you can go and read it. Because if you have it go live, then it's just going to get a track scanner. Okay. And it's
going
to be a part of it. Unless it's that type of site, that's a whole other thing.
I was just looking at the price.
Okay.
But I will.
$349 for the full shebang.
Where is it?
Yeah, it's midway down in the middle of the themes.
$349 for, that's for everything?
Everything.
For everything, yeah.
Yeah, but if you click on, I think, learn more and see price on that,
and that's the onesie twosies.
I can answer that, but I'm going to open up the group. What exactly is a framework?
That's such an ambiguous question. It's hard to answer.
What's your answer?
My answer is the base code for all the challenges you see in Genesis. Life is basic, black and white, nothing to it. You need a framework to make any of these things work.
To me, it's essentially a canvas, so it's a theme plus additional stuff. Woo Themes is a framework, but not as extensive as Genesis, kind of. So it's a lot of the stuff that Gregg was showing the options, theme options. A lot of frameworks, you know, some basic frameworks just have a few options that you can choose, and they call those frameworks. Genesis, I think, is a true framework because it's really a development platform, but there's several Genesis thesis,
Headway,
page lines. I'm not endorsing it, I'm just saying, I've slammed it here enough, I can at least mention it.
So is there like different categories of frameworks? For example, Ruby on Rails is a framework, but that's like...
That's an application framework. These are WordPress theme frameworks.
Okay, so there's different categories of frameworks. Okay.
Oh, yeah. It is a bit of a gray area, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's a pretty big term.
Yeah. What else? Yeah.
It seems like most of the conversation has been around, I guess, how to do things. What's a resource or where would be a good place to look for integrating the business aspect of it, like design for conversions, design for tracking or optimizing customer flow through your website. Conversation around that, and that's not necessarily, you know, how do I create custom posts, but how do I optimize to get my customer from a homepage visit down to a conversion, newsletter sign up, that sort of thing.
Thank you.
It's not like one resource to be able to do that, because it encompasses so many different aspects. So, for example, when you have all the UX stuff, Specifically, what you're talking about is like all the Google tracking. There's a ton of that.
Yeah.
You can probably find stuff on Smash Magazine, some great tutorials on that. I don't know if anybody else has any other examples of some great examples of Google and WordPress conversions and things like that. I would, a lot of A/B testing, that's a whole other vertical you can look through.
Talk to some of the business people here. If there was a company who would introduce themselves as SEO people or...
Grab a pizza boy.
People who are, on the business end of things. I mean, like Steve said, this group is a great resource, so you really don't have to go much farther.
Absolutely. You've asked a very broad question, but there is some expertise here. This specifically is developer day, which is why we talk about a lot of code and development type of resources. Our other meetup that we lead at the end of the month is our general meetup, and that typically is more about uses of WordPress, but not exactly. Sometimes we talk about what you're talking about, not exactly. There's a lot of crossover, but I'm a brand name. Raise your hand, I'll get you in 1 second. Raise your hand if you're more of a business person rather than a developer. So those are some of the people you might talk to after meetup, say.
Well, I'm both. I did development for business specifically, but I was also going to say what he said was UX, that stands for user experience, or UXI, which is user experience interface, which you should Google. And it's a whole other area of study, if you will, the user. So it's like something else you can get into, and that's irrespective of the platform that's being used. That's just really design.
And next week in our next dev, it's blanked on your
Athens.
No, the office.
Oh, Kelly Cole.
Kelly is going to do a whole thing on Google. Oh. So that'll be.
Absolutely. So at our next meetup in 2 weeks from tonight, we've got Athens coming, and Kelly Cole, our production manager, is going to speak specifically about understanding Google Analytics, which most people don't. I don't. So it's a presentation I'm looking forward to.
There's a huge amount of information on the WordCamp.tv site. Just a ton of different topics that run the gamut, and they're not necessarily about WordPress, and they do talk about business and user interface and all that stuff. So, I mean, sometimes you click on something that's not in English, but you get what you pay for.
So you put it in English for a second.
I've been getting a lot of Spanish and I don't know what Asian languages.
you saw some of the people who raised their hands. One of the other people you might want to reach out to who also works out of this office is Dave Cole. On Twitter, it's Hey Dave Cole. He is the inventor of Dasher, and that's one of his areas of expertise, is specifically conversion and understanding analytics, click-through rates, conversion rates. That he actually understands the science behind all of that.
I also do this too, so if you want to talk to me afterwards,
thank you.
I can give you
what's your
answers
name?
And questions. Yvette.
There you go.
Thank you.
Yep. What else? Can't be that. Yep.
Did you say at themes, the people are coming?
At themes will be here in 2 weeks. Yep.
So cool. I just saw one.
Cool.
Really
cool. Excellent. Dave and I actually spoke at San Francisco. That's where we were 2 weeks ago when Jeff Turner was leading the meeting here. So I don't know if you saw my comment on the Facebook group. It's a different kind of meetup up in San Francisco. Not what I was expecting at all. I was expecting very social and organic and not oh my god.
What did you get?
They're used to coming in, sitting down, watching a PowerPoint presentation, and going home. Exactly. That's what I thought. Yeah. So when Dave and I got up, Dave spoke for about half an hour, and I spoke for about 45 minutes. And for those of you who know me, I lead all of my presentations just like this. It's always very conversational. They weren't used to that. They weren't used to interacting. And it sort of threw them off guard at first. But they came up to both of us afterwards and said it was one of the best presentations they'd ever seen. So, again, the people that preceded us the month before was salon.com. And they said, we blew them out of the water.
Nice.
So, I like that. But again, I thought, I mean, the purpose of Meetup is this, is to meet up and talk and interact. And I mean, it's not the same. It's not what we experience in San Francisco. So every Meetup's going to be a little bit different. Anyway, I think we'll end there. For those of you who don't know, we drink both during and after the Meetup. So we reconvene at the House of Brews in Huntington Harbor. If you need directions, let me know. If you need on the Facebook group, let me know that as well. Feel free to spend some time, interact, meet each other, and
we'll
see you
until the lights go on and off.
I only have
the whole
show.
We need to just go to the right.